Enrico is the professor at UC Irvine. He has been the director of the Laboratory for Fluorescence Dynamics for a number of years. He was instrumental in developing lifetime imaging back in 1980 and has been at the forefront of studying cell dynamics using both live imaging and fluorescence. In particular, lifetime imaging, where you can look at the change in very, very short times as fluorescence decays and use that as an indicator of environment. So, Enrico?
Yes, I don't know if you can see me, but I have the screen and my presentation. Can you see that?
Everything is great. Go ahead.
Okay, so I will talk today about dynamic super-resolution in optical microscopy, and I will define a little bit what I mean by dynamics and what I meant by super-resolution in optical microscopy. And this beginning slide, you have two images. I don't know if you see my mouse moving. And so in the left, you have something that has been acquired very recently, which has to do with the formation of liquid-liquid phase separation in the nucleus. And here the problem is to see molecules, when the molecules can in or out of those structures, and if those structures have any biological significance. In the right side, you have an example of a technique which we call spectral phaser, which means that we can do hyperspectral imaging of every image that we can see, and that will be very important for what I will say in the context of this talk. Okay, so first of all, I want to say something about super resolution. So super resolution is the word that is used to indicate that the resolution that you can obtain in an image is about on the order of 10-20 nanometer, as become today, and that is far better than the diffraction limited resolution, which is about a factor of 10, between 100 and 200 nanometer that you can obtain with normal microscopy and confocal microscopy. Why that is important? Well, it's important because life, which is what we are trying to understand and to look at the various phenomena, is made of of biomolecular reaction. And the biomolecular reaction occurs at the scale, which is really the nanoscale. So if you look at an image at 200 nanometer, you cannot really recognize the molecules which are involved in the chemical reaction. But super resolution imaging has been used, or is mainly used, in order to obtain, I would say, stunning images, but very little is has been done, except in few labs, in order to obtain the dynamics, which is at the basis of life. So in our resource, E41 resource, LRD, we have been working in part to fill in the gap by developing what I will call the enabling technologies that will open the potential for super resolution imaging to dynamics in the microsecond to millisecond time scale. And you will see what are those enabling technologies, probably are not very well known, but I hope after my talk, you will understand what we are trying to do. So, and I will describe, I said in this webinar, a technology. So first of all, what we are doing is the following thing. We would like to acquire information about the number of location of many molecular species, and that can be proteins, can be NADH, can be ATP or whatever in a cell. And we want to be able to do that in a very small volume, and in this very small volume to acquire many different parameters. And then, for example, we want to also use different techniques like multiphoton imaging, because multiphoton imaging penetrate in tissue much more than normal one photon excitation. We would like us to have the capability to do fluorescence polarization, fluorescence of time decay, hyperspectral imaging, and spatial correlation of fast fluctuation. Why is that important? Because that will give us, like in a single image, in a single recording, the information about the many events which are at the basis of life. How to reach that? Why people have not been able to do that? Well, because essentially, if you want to have a camera that can look at many pixels at a time, the camera has to be fast. And the cameras that we are using at the present time can obtain, in terms of frames per second, which is a familiar parameter to indicate the camera, on the order of 1,000,000 frames per second. So this is not a mistake. This is the capability to obtain all the parameters I am talking in this part, but at a rate which is really incredible and with a high resolution and with a possibility to measure many parameters at the same time. How does it work? So it works, and you can show here something that you imagine that your resolution of the microscope, the point spread function, you can localize in an area which is here described by this hexagon. At the hexagon, you have a fiber optics in each one of those corners of the hexagon. You have a fiber optics that then is imaged in a camera. And this is the picture of the camera. So this camera has 8 by 8 elements, 8 by 8 elements actually. Not all can be used in an hexagonal shape, but most of it. And then each element has an output, which is a cathode. And using this output, as I show in the next slide, we can obtain the information of every pixel of the camera. And in every pixel of the camera, using electronics that have developed in part of my lab, but other labs have also, you can obtain information about the decay time of every species that you have there in the nanosecond time scale, in every single element of the camera. And then in order to use special information, you can use, for example, two of those cameras. And each camera, so the sum of the two cameras will have like 128 channels of lifetime. And this is something I think nobody has done until now, but this is essentially almost becoming a commercial instrument. So you start from here, and you have a laser, and we use most of the information is obtained with, in this case, with the wide laser unit. The wide laser unit produces some pulses of light, which are about 10 picosecond, which is not femtosecond, so you cannot do two-photon excitation. And then it goes in a unit, which is the steady unit. And this is very important. So the steady unit is a unit that will give us the super resolution based on the steady principle I will show in a few slides. Then once the light is either passed to the steady unit or not, it will go to the microscope, and the microscope has a scanner in which you can center the image and then acquire the image with the microscope. The fluorescence light, which is emitted by the microscope, is going through this detector that we call the Vespa, because it looks like, if you watch, look at them, they look like the eyes of a big bee. So what is the advantage of doing something like that? So the advantage is that we can obtain a really very large number of frames per second. And this is given because you can read every element of the this detector in a microsecond. So everything in parallel goes to what we call the flim box, and we can obtain all the information I said before, fluctuation, lifetime, spectral, and so on, directly, but at a very high speed. And every pixel of this camera is measured separately and independently. So for example, we can obtain the fluorescence decay at every pixel, the fluorescence spectrum at every pixel. I talk here specifically spectrum, not only a wavelength selection, image out fluctuation among all the pixels. So for example, fluctuation which occur in one pixel with another pixel and so on. And so that will give us an idea of where the molecules move, and we will show some example about that. So all the parts are commercial, are available today, the detector you can buy, the a wide laser you can buy. Essentially, it's a question of assembling and maybe to have the software to run everything. And for the visitor to our center, all this instrument is ready to be used and is used very much today. Okay. So the next slide shows some examples. And I divided the example in three kind of examples. In the first example, we want to exploit the content super resolution. So I mean that in the same pixel, you can measure many different molecular species. And that will give us an advantage because we can obtain information about the molecular species responsible for a given biochemical reaction, or in this case, you know, causing fibrosis in a bone. And you can obtain that on a relatively large area. So this is not an error, again, this is 2 millimeters. So those bones are on the order of 12 millimeters, something like that. So it's a relatively large sample. If you pay attention, you see that there are like regions in which we do tiling in order to get this information. What is painted here is the following thing. So it's essentially information we want to extract for every pixel of an image. Now, collagens have a combination of fluorescence, so most collagens are fluorescent too, if you have enough sensitivity to see that, and produce second harmonic generation. But the fluorescence and the second harmonic generation comes to exactly a given wavelength, but the fluorescence can come to very different wavelengths. So by combination of the emission filter, or by using the spectral detector, we can separate all the different type of collagen. And so you can see here that in a bone, you can see, for example, second harmonic generation, which is that signal here, how it forms. And then you can see all the interior, which is a different kind of collagen, because it has not second harmonic generation, but has fluorescence and so on. And this example shows also here that by measuring separately the different molecular species, you can directly obtain maps of the different molecular species. For example, this is maps of fibrosis in a kidney in a mouse. And you can see here the fiber all painted in green. And when you get a normal kidney, well, that is the control, and you can see very, very little of those fibers. So to give you an idea, this image is obtained, whatever, in about a few minutes, and then the fibers are detected only by selecting the molecular species that you want to see. In other labs in which they don't have this capability, for example, the fibers are obtained by an artificial intelligence process in which you can trace a fiber in this structure. Of course, you have to instruct the computer to do that. And then, you know, clearly this is an entangle of many, many fibers, so it's very difficult to obtain. But here, the resolution is obtained directly by telling the computer to plot one particular species. And that is really what I meant by content super resolution based on spectral and lifetime data. So you can see that you can measure specimen that comes from clinical studies directly with our instrument. And this is a collaboration with Dr. Moshe Levy and Suman Ranjit. And this is one of the original paper. Also, Ron Evans from Scripps Clinics was involved also in this research. Okay, so let's go to the next example. So the next example requires a background which I try to do in only one slide, that tell us how we measure the decay. So suppose here you have the decay, which has a lifetime tau 1. Okay, so has a lifetime tau 1. So that can be represented by a transformation, which is called the phase of transformation, which is nothing but the Fourier transform, in an angle and the interface. The angle will be smaller the shorter is the lifetime. And this is an example, for example, of a longer lifetime, so a longer decay. And the modulation also follow and has to be, if it's a single exponential, around this universal circle. And this is just a simple transformation. And you say, why you want to do that? Well, we want to do that for a very simple reason, that being the coordinate of this point, a Fourier transform, that means that the coordinates are orthogonal one to the other. And then we can apply the law of linear combinational phase. For example, suppose you have a phase which is in this position, and that position can be, for example, a free NADH in solution, and has a lifetime of 0.4 nanoseconds, so has a very low phase, but when it bounds to a protein, becomes much longer, so 3.4 nanoseconds, for example. And that will be the point. Now, when you measure in a pixel of a cell the combination of free unbound NADH, which is one of the indexes that we use in order to determine the metabolism of the cell, you will get, for example, a distribution of points which indicate that different pixels in a cell have different ratio of the bound to free NADH. Now, that ratio is very important because it's related to a metabolic index. So if that distribution will move toward an NADH bound, that means that you have more oxyphos kind of metabolism, and if move in the other direction, you will have much more of the glycolytic kind of metabolism. So just by looking at this ratio, which is obtained with only one line of the laser, well, this is a second harmonic generation, and then you can obtain an index which moves along a line, and you can determine with great precision not only what is the average of every single cell in the field of view, but also in within a cell, you can separate the mitochondria, the nucleus, and all the different compartments of the cell. So this is the use we will make of the phaser, and then you will see more later on. So now the question is, in this case, for example, you can see very clearly that we can distinguish one lifetime from another lifetime. Well, what if we have other? For example, you see that combination there, which indicates that there is another value. Well, we can, using software that was developed in my lab, you can distinguish three or four or more different species. So let us make an example that we use in a steady instrument, and those are various kind of Alexa. This is Alexa for 647. This is Atto 647. And we use those two probes because those are very useful for steady resolution. So suppose you have those two probes, and you can see if you have just in solution, they occupy two very different places. If you use those two probes conjugated with DNA, and then you put in a cell, well, you will see that actually they form like a cloud that goes from a point, which is the autofluorescence of the cell, of that particular cell, and then but nevertheless, you can distinguish very clearly where the Atto 647 is, where the Alex is, and maybe the combination of the two, because they give us completely different patterns, and you will see later on how that is used. Okay, so at the present time, based on lifetime, so you can have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lifetime, and then you can have also different spectra because they have some of the molecules of different spectra. So we can distinguish about 20 different in this case, DNA conjugates. And then that, of course, is very important for analysis of gene in single cell. So let us see how that is useful in the following slide. So suppose we have three probes, one which is, for example, Atto, Alexa, one which is the Atto, and the other which is a combination of the two. So you can see clearly that the probes have different lifetime, and then you can separate, for example, and paint three colors, the blue one, the green one, and the yellow one. In this case, we use an algorithm which is based on artificial intelligence, but I can tell you that you can distinguish by eye those three cluster very well. The reason to use artificial intelligence is because you want to make many, many elements when we use super solution of the cell, and then you will need to analyze many, many different points. And although you can see by eye where the difference is between those three probes, you cannot really beat the speed of a computer that will, in a few whatever microsecond, will tell you how to clusterize those three lifetimes. Then you can paint a color red, that will be where that particular DNA, or in this particular case, this RNA is found, the other where it's found, and the other is found. And then you can do 3D. And then here is the example. For example, what you see in channel 1, channel 2, channel 3, those are different number of cells. This is the dyes that we were using. And this is the gene, the specific gene that we were trying to understand what it is. So up to this point, I think that there are commercial instruments that can do equal or better of what we have here. But the point is, first of all, this is done in only one measurement. So we don't have wash to have one kind of DNA or another kind and so on. So it's done essentially in the same thing. But the real advantage of that comes when you can apply a super resolution techniques, like, for example, a STED. So STED, in the STED measurement, you have an excitation beam, which is shown here in blue, and then you have a depletion beam in which you deplete all the molecules that you have excited with the excitation beam, except in a very small area. And that small area can be made as small as you wish, depending on the intensity used in the depletion beam. So, for example, this is a piece of an image that was in the previous slide. This is the dimension of this image. And you can see that here you have something that you believe is maybe one RNA or something like that. Maybe you have another. But when you look at very high resolution, the resolution which is given by the STED image, you can see that actually that was not one, but was one, two, three, four. And that was not one, but was two, and so on. And the distance, so the resolution that you can use, because we have lifetime in this particular case, is on the order of 15 nanometer. So this is so those points differ one from the other by a very small distance. This is important because you would like to know if the genes that are expressed in a given part of the cell are really the same if one gene is expressed in the other part or in the other side of the cell. So if the proximity one to the other has any kind of advantage or will produce different proteins in the cell. So when you look at this image, you say, well, yes, really, that is different than just counting the number of spots that you see in this image. And not only, but you have a resolution. This resolution is on this order that you will need in order to see splicing if the are of the same RNA and so on. Okay, so let's go to the next point, which is the other example I want to show, which is in collaboration with Hao Yang from the University of Virginia, and in which we want to track what happens in the borders or at the interface between the liquid and then the rest of the nucleus in this particular case. And it's known that if you frap or you bleach one of those phase separation, it recovers in a certain amount of time. But this measurement doesn't tell you where, the frap doesn't tell you where the molecule that recover have coming from. So the question is, can we look in a stationary at equilibrium one of those spots and figuring out where the molecules are coming? So here are two different mutants of the same protein in which we can see, for example, bipolarization, which means a measurement of homothreat, which means the proximity of two molecules is different from one mutant than the other. And this is, again, one more example of the kind of measurement that you can do in those liquid-liquid phase separation stuff. And then you can obtain fraction, you can obtain a partition coefficient and all the other. But still that doesn't, it's telling you that what is the status of that particle. So yes, you can have fret or more fret or less fret, but doesn't tell you where are coming the particles. So this can be done by another technique, which is based on the dynamics. So the dynamics means that you measure the fluctuation in one point, for example, here, in another point, and so on, and you see the molecules that are producing the fluctuation moving in a given region. For example, this is in one of those spots is the intensity, but if you measure the anisotropy of the motion, which is anisotropy of the diffusion, you can see, for example, that there are variables in some region, and there are variables because simply the molecules move in one direction and cannot cross that. But there are other regions, for example, in which the particles can or the molecules can move in. And then at the end, you can obtain a map of what we call the connectivity of the cell, which means how molecules will move in the presence of obstacle, which is something that is very difficult to measure with any other method as far as we know. Okay, so this is another example. So in conclusion, I want to thank all the people of my lab, and in particular, the people who did some of the experiment. This is Rupsa Datta and Suman Ranjit and Alex Sasha Vornikov, who did most of the development of this kind of microscopy. And also, I want to say that we are part of the National Institute of General Medicine Science. Our lab is called the LFD. You can find our lab in the website. It's simply Google for LFD, and you will find all the activities that we have, and also how to get access to our center. Generally, it's very similar to what you do for synchrotron radiation. So you send a proposal. There is a committee that will review your proposal. You discuss the proposal, if it's feasible or not, and then essentially you can come and do your measurement in our center. And I think this is the last slide, and I thank you very much for your attention, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk in this way.